I'm thinking of trying to capture that sort of aqua color around the distant rocks, and then maybe, you know, a bigger wave in the foreground. What do you think?
I agree. I originally wanted to focus just on a wave, but I think the rocks, especially the one in the distance, have a nice flow to the composition, but I'm definitely going to try to put a wave in there somewhere.
I'm going to go with a high horizon. Are you going with a high horizon, Araya, too?
Yep.
And the rocks kind of come out like this, maybe over to here. And I want to keep the bottom of these rocks that are in the closer area here. I want to keep them above maybe the halfway point, or maybe just a little bit below. Some white water like this. Maybe even go higher with the horizon, something like that. Although there's some clouds, it's fog basically, but it might be nice to have some fog and then blue skies above it. Okay, and the waves kind of coming in this way. That's actually quite a bit of sand though. I'm not sure I want that much sand. Maybe I'll something like that. So are you gonna have these rocks in the distance go all the way across the back?
No, I'm gonna have
It's gonna end right there.
Yeah, it's gonna end right here. I don't want it to end in the middle, so I push it over. I figured I neither needed to make it end over here or end over here and not in the middle, but if I ended it over here, this rock wouldn't be very visible.
Right.
So I decided to end it over here, and then I'm gonna create some of that nice toothpaste-y whitewater color
that
we saw in there.
Gotcha. And then this obviously is gonna be your reflective sand here and then dry sand there.
Yeah, I wanna get some of that nice purple that comes through there.
And this is 11 by 14?
Yes,
oh, 11 by 14, cool.
Yeah.
Looks like you gessoed over like an inexpensive panel.
Precisely, yeah. I used your method with the pumice. I don't know if I'm giving away your secrets here.
No, that's all right. I've already shared my trade secrets. So you put a bit of pumice in there.
And one extra coat of gesso just because, you know, it's never the store-bought stuff is always too porous.
Yeah, exactly. Starting with my usual dark mixture of ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, and some alizarin crimson. I'm just trying to focus on simple shapes here. One thing I'm noticing is the bottom of these rocks out here is kind of a straight line. I don't want that. I want to break that up a little bit. So I may have a few rocks or something. So this bottom isn't a straight line. Plus there'll be white water here, which will break it up as well. All right, and I'm squinting at the scene to simplify the shapes. Kind of a dark pattern there. And then this rock in the foreground is mostly in light, but there are a few shadows. And there's an interesting shadow shape over here. But the scale is out of whack. This has got to be smaller. Okay, for the distant water, I've got a mixture of phthalo blue, ultramarine blue, a touch of burnt sienna, and some titanium white. And I'm starting with a mid-tone value just to get the panel covered. As I've mentioned out here, there's some white water and also breaking waves. Beautiful, minty, sort of toothpaste color, as Araya said. But I'm not gonna worry about that for now. First, I just wanna get the big shapes established and then I can start putting waves in. This area in the foreground is predominantly white water. All right, for the wet sand that's reflecting the sky, I've got titanium white, ultramarine blue, a touch of alizarin crimson, and I'm graying it down with some of this burnt sienna. And I'm keeping the value at about a mid-tone. I want the white water to stand out against this reflected sky in the sand. One of the big challenges painting this reflected sky is that the value is changing constantly. As the water rushes out, it gets lighter. Maybe the wetter the sand is, the darker it is, I think. I think that's what it is. But as usual, I'm looking for an interesting shape here as well. Alright, the sand mixture is yellow ochre, titanium white, burnt sienna, and a bit of ultramarine blue. I can already tell this color is going to be too cool, but that's alright. I don't mind having some cool tones under warm tones, so I can warm it up and then leave this cooler scrub in. It's nice to have the warm and cool playing off each other. Another thing I pay attention to is the value of the sand. It's really easy to paint it too light, but I want the white water to stand out against the sand. I want the white water to be the brightest part of the painting. Mixing in a bit of cadmium yellow medium and burnt sienna. I'm gonna exaggerate the warmth in these rocks in the foreground. It'll help establish a sense of depth. Maybe a bit more color and contrast in these rocks than in the ones in the distance. All right, mixing in a little bit of my dark mixture here. This portion of the rocks is pretty dark actually, so I'm gonna darken that up a little bit. All right, and there's a light portion on the rocks in the distance. So I'm using a cooler mixture so that I get a little bit of separation here. All right, I'm seeing a problem here. These lines are mimicking each other. And I'm gonna knock down the top of this rock here. The contour of this distant rock will be more visible when I scrub in the sky. I've got the wet sand mixture here, but I added some titanium white for the clouds or the fog in the distance. And I want the value to be light, but I also want it to be slightly darker than the lights on this rock, which I will be adding. And I'm gonna try to keep the shape of the fog somewhat erratic and unpredictable. A lot of times the fog is just a straight line, not very interesting, but again, using the scenery as raw materials for colors, values, etc., I can change things for compositional reasons or for any reason for that matter. Okay, there we go. I love how you get this like scrubby look in the beginning. Are you using any medium on this? It almost looks like the paint's going on fairly dry.
I'm using liquid here and there, but I'm trying to be sparing about it.
You're gonna have a wave right here.
Yep.
And
I'm gonna have a splash coming up.
Okay.
And this rock, and then this whole inside area is gonna be white water.
Okay, great.
Hopefully. Yeah.
And by keeping it thin and scrubby like this, you can come over with that thicker paint without having to fight it too much.
And still get some of that coming from below, yeah.
Exactly. For this portion of the sky, I've got titanium white and phthalo blue green shade. And the phthalo I use typically is from Utrecht, but I know that phthalo can lean in various different directions. And like I said, the one from Utrecht is phthalo blue green shade. And I can't do without this color. It just, it's really nice for aquas in the water. But then also I use it for my skies almost every time. Okay, got pure titanium white here. And I'm using a number 6 natural bristle flat. And I'll probably use this same brush for the whole painting. For now, I'm keeping this paint fairly thin. I'm just using it compositionally and not really committed to these shapes. But if I, you know, when I come up with something I like, then I can reinforce the white water. And by applying the white too, I can also see if my values need to be adjusted. I may actually need to darken this blue color here. The waves in the distance have almost a purple color to them. And rise up higher over to the left. There's some purple areas around the base of the rocks as well. So important to make sure that you're observing and not on autopilot. The waves seem like they're breaking first over to the left, and then this portion will be unbroken and I can get some color in there. This water in this area is a lot bluer, and then the wave in the foreground is a lighter green. One of the things I'm always trying to remember to do is keep the waves messy or irregular. It's so easy to tidy them up, you know?
100%.
It's just not the way they are. Okay, right over here, there's kind of a blue-green, the wave rises up and there's these beautiful blue-greens in there. Right here, it's like zigzag, zigzag. That's no good. It's a little better. Adding some lighter greens at the base of this wave. I'm realizing that this mix is crucial because part of what I was attracted to in the scene is this blue-green or aqua color.
Uh-huh.
And I can tell already that I'm gonna need to darken the surrounding water to make this pop. But by having some of those key elements established, then I can adjust things accordingly. I added some titanium white to lighten up the mixture for this area in here. I added some cadmium yellow medium and phthalo blue for this portion of the wave. There's also some white water that comes up the face of the wave. I don't know if I'll try to capture that, but maybe. The sun is coming out. All the colors are changing, of course. There's some little waves in the foreground that have a lot more yellow in them. Try to include some of those. All right, Ryan, you're losing your shade over here.
Right?
And that's gonna start getting hot. All right, so you're almost covered.
Almost, I got caught using a small brush. I just caught myself, so.
What, a small brush? What?
I know.
You need to throw that in the ocean.
Blasphemy.
All right, when I come back with thicker paint, I am still working dark to light. So I just start with the darks, reinforcing them. All right, I do need to darken these rocks out here if I want this aqua color to stand out. That dark value there helps make the white water pop, also makes this blue water read better. Because I want this to be a point of interest, having the higher contrast there is a good thing. It'll draw the eye. Titanium white, phthalo blue, and cadmium yellow medium. I can tell that's too dark. Adding some titanium white.
So you start a new pile when you want to lighten the paint up a little bit?
Yeah, and I'll use this for the water, so I'll still use it, but I knew I was too dark, so I needed to, if I started mixing titanium white in here, I'd use my whole pile before I got where I needed to be, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a lot easier to darken the color than lighten it.
Yeah. This number 6 holds a decent amount of paint, actually. As long as it's new, you know, once they get older, then the party's over. You end up scraping off more paint than you apply, you know? I think I want to punch up the color in this area here to have, you know, warm versus cool. It is hard to get crazy on a panel of this size, 12 by 16, because I feel like I'm gonna lose, I'll lose the shapes.
Right.
That's why it'd be nice with a zoomed out view like this. It would be nice to do it on a bigger panel. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
Oh, no, no. I was just going to say you want to get loose, but you want to maintain the integrity of what the shapes you're painting.
Exactly. And when the shapes are kind of small, you just have to be careful. Otherwise, you'll lose it. I don't want to just paint over all of this. I just want to add a few touches of light on the rocks. This might be too warm, but I do want to have thick and thin on these rocks. And I want to apply the paint with intention. There's a little light on the top of the rocks here. All right, if you look at this rock in the foreground, it's actually pretty cool in color. So I'm gonna exaggerate the warmth to hopefully create a feeling of light, but also a feeling of depth. Love all that crazy energy, thick paint down there.
Thank you, I had some coaching.
It looks great, man, looks good.
Yeah, thanks for talking me through that.
Oh, of course, of course. I love those colors in there as well. Like, it's always challenging to get that white water as it goes up the face of the wave.
Extremely.
Yeah. All right, so here is what I finished up with. I definitely pushed the saturation in this painting, in particular in the blue-greens in the water, and then also the orange tones in the rocks in the foreground. The rocks in the foreground were actually more of a gray color, but I decided to change them to orange in order to help create a feeling of light. I also like the idea of a nice complementary relationship between the blues of the water and the oranges of the rocks. And then also, I wanted to warm them up to bring them forward in the picture plane to create some separation with the distant rocks. I'm actually really pleased with the level of saturation. I pushed things, but I don't feel like I went too far. Just far enough, hopefully, to help recreate the lived experience of actually standing in front of the scene. All right, so I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know what you think in the comments. I will put a link to Arai's Instagram in the description below, so check out his work. Also, if you'd like to see some extra videos and help support the channel, there's a Patreon link down below. It's the Patreon support that helps keep me making these videos, and it's much appreciated. So like I said, check it out. Other than that, stay creative, and I'll see you guys in the next video.